Hello students, the practical which we are going to see is to perform assay of copper sulfate. So the principle for this assay is iodometric titration. In the titrant which we are going to use is sodium thiosulfate, which acts as a reducing agent.
So before moving on to actual practical, let us see the introduction. So we are going to perform assay of copper sulfate. So what is copper sulfate? Copper 2 sulfate, it is also known as copper sulfate. It is the inorganic compound with the chemical formula CuSO4H2OX. So here you can see this compound contains water of hydration and X can range from 0 to 5. So if X is 0, that is it will be anhydrous copper sulfate. It exists in various forms. So pentahydrate form, that is CuSO4 5H2O, is the most common form. Copper sulfate is also known as blue vitriol. Molecular weight of CuSO4 5H2O is 249.7 gram per mole. It occurs as the blue crystals or granules or as deep blue crystalline powder. So you can see here the various forms of copper sulfate. You can see the crystals. Second diagram shows the granules. And in third one, you can see the powder form. So it can exist in various forms like crystals, granules and powder. And it is blue in color. Hence its synonym is also blue vitriol. Solubility of copper sulfate. It is soluble in water and methanol, but it is insoluble in ethanol. It readily dissolves in aqueous ammonia and excess alkali metal cyanides with the formation of complexes. Copper sulfate, the compound is used as a fungicide and herbicide. It is also used as analytical reagent and it is used in organic synthesis also. So why we need to perform the assay? Assay means to find out percentage purity of the pharmaceutical substance. So it is very important to determine purity of pharmaceutical substances. So be it API or be it the test sample, it is very important to determine the purity. Purity of dosage forms need also to be established. So one of the method is to perform assay. So there are various methods like assay by UV spectroscopy, assay by volumetric analysis. So we are going to perform assay of copper sulfate by the titration, which is a volumetric analysis. So aim is to perform assay of copper sulfate. Requirements. So apparatus we will require are burette, pipettes, then conical flask, rubber bulb, butter paper, spatula, weighing balance. Chemicals we will require copper sulfate, then sodium thiosulfate, which should be previously standardized. Now sodium thiosulfate is not a primary standard, it is a secondary standard. Hence its concentration should be assured before the proceeding with assay. So we have to first standardize sodium thiosulfate. Indicator we are going to use is starch indicator. Then we will require distilled water, potassium iodide, glacial acetic acid and sodium carbonate. Principle is it is based on the redox reactions and it is a type of iodometric titration. So iodometric, that is the liberated iodine will be titrated against the sodium thiosulfate. Iodine will act as oxidizing agent where it will oxidize sodium thiosulfate. Whereas sodium thiosulfate acts as a reducing agent, it is going to reduce the iodine which is liberated in the conical flask. So copper sulfate in the acidic media, we have seen in the requirements glacial acetic acid. So we are going to add glacial acetic acid. So copper sulfate in the acidic media reacts with potassium iodide and forms cupric iodide. This cupric iodide then breaks up into cuprous iodide and liberates iodine. Now this liberated iodine we are going to titrate against sodium thiosulfate using starch as indicator. Iodine is a strong oxidizing agent which leads to oxidation of sodium thiosulfate while iodine itself gets reduced. Sodium thiosulfate is a weak reducing agent. So reactions you can see copper sulfate plus potassium iodide. We will get cupric iodide. Cupric iodide then breaks into cuprous iodide and iodine is liberated. So you can see that 2 moles of copper sulfate it liberates 1 mole of iodine. So let us see the factor calculation. As we have seen in the reaction, 2 mole of copper sulfate will liberate 1 mole of iodine. 1 mole of iodine is equivalent to 2 moles of sodium thiosulfate. We have seen this in the standardization practical. So from above 2 equations, you can see that 2 moles of copper sulfate is equivalent to 2 moles of sodium thiosulfate. So we can write 2 into 249.7, that is molecular weight of copper sulfate pentahydrate, is equal to 1000 ml of 1 molar iodine, which is again equal to 2 into 1000 ml of 1 molar sodium thiosulfate. So 2 into 249.7 gram of copper sulfate pentahydrate is equal to 2 into 1000 ml of 1 molar sodium thiosulfate. So by eliminating 2 from both the sides, we get 249.7 gram of copper sulfate pentahydrate is equal to 1000 ml of 1 molar sodium thiosulfate. Now, instead of 1000 ml, if we convert it into 1 ml and instead of 1 molar, if we take 0.1 molar, then we get 0.02497 gram of copper sulfate. So 0.02497 gram of copper sulfate pentahydrate is equivalent to 1 ml of 0.1 molar sodium thiosulfate. Now as molarity and normality of sodium thiosulfate is same, we can also say that 0.02497 gram of copper sulfate pentahydrate is equivalent to 1 ml of 0.1 normal sodium thiosulfate. So this is how we have calculated the factor for copper sulfate and sodium thiosulfate with the help of reactions. So this factor we are going to use in our final calculations. So now let us see the procedure of actual assay. So for this we have to weigh our compound, that is copper sulfate. We will weigh 0.5 gram of copper sulfate and dissolve it in 25 ml of distilled water. Then we have to add little amount of sodium carbonate. We are adding sodium carbonate to remove any free mineral acid as impurity. So we will add sodium carbonate until the solution appears slightly turbid. Now to make the solution clear, we are going to add glacial acetic acid. So add glacial acetic acid drop by drop till the solution becomes clear. When solution becomes clear, add an excess of 2.5 ml of glacial acetic acid. Then add 1.5 gram of potassium iodide. And then make the final volume up to 100 ml with distilled water using volumetric flask. So in the conical flask, we will have copper sulfate as well as potassium iodide. So as we have seen in the principle, reaction will take place and iodine will be liberated. Now fill the burette with previously standardized sodium thiosulfate solution and start the titration in the iodine flask using sodium thiosulfate solution. Iodometric practical are generally carried out in the iodine flask to minimize the air oxidation. When the color of iodine solution becomes less intense, then we have to add starch solution. Now why we are adding starch towards the end? Because if we add initially, then starch will form the strong complex with iodine, which will not break even at the end point. So we will add starch once the solution becomes faint yellow in color, so that it indicates that iodine has been reduced by sodium thiosulfate. So on adding starch, solution will become blue in color. Continue to titrate against sodium thiosulfate solution till the blue color gets discharged. So what are the key points to be kept in mind while performing this titration? Always add indicator towards the end. Titration should be performed in iodine flask to minimize air oxidation of iodine. So iodine flask has narrow mouth and it contains stopper. So we can use iodine flask. Now, how to prepare starch indicator? It is very important to prepare the indicator properly. So for this, we have to weigh 1 gram of starch. You can weigh corn or potato starch, whichever is available, and then mix it with 10 ml of distilled water. Now add the suspension to 100 ml of boiling water. Stir with the help of glass rod and boil further for 5 minutes. Allow the solution to cool and use this cooled solution as the indicator. Now remember, we always have to use freshly prepared starch indicator. Now before moving on to the performance part, let us see what are the precautions to be taken while performing the practical. So always wash all the glassware with distilled water. Use funnel while transferring any weighed substance into the volumetric flask, so that your weighed substance will go directly into the center of the flask. If you do not use funnel, then what happens? Your substance may get stick to the wall of the volumetric flask, and that substance will not dissolve in your solvent. So it will lead to loss of your substance. Pour the solution with help of funnel into the burette. So to avoid any spilling, we have to use funnel while pouring the titrant into the burette. And once you fill the burette, immediately remove the funnel, because if you keep the funnel as it is during titration, what will happen? Some drops from the funnel may drop into the burette, and this will lead to the false burette reading, and it will affect your results. So therefore, while performing titration, remove the funnel from the mouth of the burette. Then remember, always use separate pipette for each of the solution to avoid any contamination. Always use rubber bulb for pipetting out solutions. Never suck any solution with help of the mouth. As we deal with chemicals, they are hazardous. So to prevent, we have to always use rubber bulb for pipetting out solutions. Now let us see the actual procedure, actual performance part of how to perform assay of copper sulfate.
Hello students, in this video we are going to see how to perform the assay of copper sulfate. So we are going to do it by the titrometric method, and the principle is iodometry. So in the conical flask we are going to add copper sulfate. We have already taken copper sulfate which has been dissolved in water. When we will add in the acidic medium, what will happen? Iodine will be liberated, and this liberated iodine is then titrated against sodium thiosulfate. So we have already standardized our sodium thiosulfate. Its standardization, its normality was found to be 0.1 to normal. We have filled sodium thiosulfate in the burette. So now let us start. We have taken copper sulfate, it has been dissolved in 25 ml of water. Now we are going to add sodium carbonate. We will add sodium carbonate until it is slightly turbid. This we are doing to remove the any acidic impurities. So you can see here it has become turbid. Now we are going to add glacial acetic acid should be handled very carefully, as it is highly strong, it is very corrosive. So will immediately close it. Now we will add until the solution becomes clear. So you can see the solution has become clear. Now we will add extra 2.5 ml. So after this we are going to add KI, that is potassium iodide. So what will happen on adding KI? You can see the reaction takes place and what will be formed? Cuprous iodide. This cupric iodide will be formed. Cupric iodide then decomposes into cuprous iodine and iodine is liberated. You can see yellow color due to liberated iodine. Now we have to make up the volume to 100 ml. We have already taken 25 ml of water. This is 75 ml of water. So total volume will be 100 ml. Now we will start titration. Indicator we are going to use is the starch paste, but it has to be added at the end, because if we add initially, what will happen? Strong bond will be formed between the iodine and starch, so it will not break. So what we will do, we will first start the titration and reduce some of the iodine. So sodium thiosulfate is going to reduce iodine. We are adding drop by drop. You can see the color is becoming faint. This is because iodine is being reduced by sodium thiosulfate. So you can see, we'll titrate some more. The color has become faint. Okay. Now we will add our indicator, that is starch. We are going to add about 2 ml of starch. That is till we obtain black color. You can see the color has changed to blackish. Due to copper sulfate, we are able to see greenish color, but you can see the black droplets which are okay. So now we will titrate our solution until it becomes colorless. That is, the color of iodine of starch gets discharged. So you can see that it is becoming whitish. Okay, so you can see it has become white. The color of iodine has disappeared. Black color has been changed to white. So this is our end point. Similarly, we will take two more readings. So now, similarly, we have prepared our solution as shown in the first, and we will proceed with the titration. You can see the yellow color due to liberated iodine. We titrate it until it becomes faint. So you can see the color has become faint. So now we will add starch indicator. Remember to add starch after the color of iodine becomes faint. We always have to use freshly prepared starch. So you can see the black color. Now we will titrate till the color of iodine gets discharged. So you can see the color change taking place. Our solution is turning colorless. So you can see the color has been discharged. So now we will proceed for the third reading. Now we will take similarly third reading. We have added in the copper sulfate solution sodium carbonate to remove acidic impurities. Then we have added glacial acetic acid to make the solution clear. Then we had added KI to liberate iodine. So we will titrate starch. We will add after color becomes faint. You can see the color is becoming faint. You can see we are carrying out this titration in the iodine flask. These are the iodine flask. So why we are carrying out in the iodine flask? Because the mouth of the iodine flask is narrow. Sorry, we have already taken the starch. So as this is redox titration, we have to save our solution from external environment. So iodine flask has narrow mouth, that is why we are using this flask. So you can see the black color. Again, we will carry titration till the color of starch gets discharged. So you can see the solution has turned white. So now we are going to see the observation table. You can see here initial reading, that is initially we had adjusted the burette mark to 0. First titration reading was 16.3 mm. So the difference is 16.3 mm. Again, by taking the second reading, we had again adjusted the solution to the mark 0. So 16.4, difference is 16.4. Similarly, third reading was 16.1 mm. So we will now take the average of all these three readings. So the average comes out to be 16.26 mm. So this burette reading, we are going to put it into the factor. So now let us see the further calculations. So we have already seen factor. 1 ml 0.1 normal sodium thiosulfate is equivalent to 0.02497 gram of copper sulfate. We have used the pentahydrate form. Okay, so it is 0.02497 gram of copper sulfate. We have already seen how to calculate the factor. So next equation will be burette reading, that is the average of the burette reading which we have just seen, into normality of Ne2SO3 which was found out by standardization. So it was 0.12 normal. So instead of 0.1, we are writing 0.12 normal. Is equivalent to x gram. So this x we have to now find out. This is the gram of copper sulfate. So the calculation is simple by cross multiplication. So finally we get this equation. So instead of burette reading, we will keep our average, that is 16.26 mm into 0.12 into 0.02497 divided by 1 and 0.1. So gram of copper sulfate comes out to be 0.48 gram. So now let us see how to calculate the percentage purity. So now let us see how to calculate percentage purity. So it is weight obtained divided by weight taken into 100. So we have seen from the calculation, weight obtained was 0.48 gram. Weight which we have taken, so in the conical flask we had taken 0.5 gram of copper sulfate into 100. So percentage purity comes out to be 96.0% weight by So the result is percentage purity of copper sulfate is found to be 96.0% weight by weight. Thank you.
So as we have seen, the purity of copper sulfate is found to be 96.0% weight by weight. So this is the result of our practical. Now let us see some of the questions for synopsis. What is volumetric analysis? So up till now we have seen many titrations. So volumetric analysis is basically the technique which involves measurement of volume of a solution whose concentration is known and applied to determine the concentration of analyte. So let us take example of this titration. Here we had previously determined the concentration of sodium thiosulfate, which was 0.12 normal. The volume of this sodium thiosulfate, that is the burette reading, we then applied to find out the concentration of copper sulfate. Classify the titration methods. So acid-based titrations. Herein we determine the concentration of acids or bases, and they are based on neutralization reactions. Then redox titrations, they are based on redox reactions. The substances have tendency to reduce or oxidize other substances and also itself get reduced or oxidized. Precipitation titrations. Herein we can determine the concentration of halides like chloride, iodide, bromide. So silver nitrate is generally used as the titrant in precipitation titrations. Further precipitation titrations can be divided or classified as Mohr's method, Fajans method and Wohlhardt's method. Next is complexometric titrations. Through complexometric titrations, we can determine the concentration of metals like calcium, magnesium, manganese. Titrant uses EDTA, that is ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid. It is a ligand which is most widely used in complexometric titrations. Give the types of redox titrations. So, they are based on the titrant which is used. So bromometry, here we use bromine as the titrant. Cerimetry, they employ cerium salts like ceric ammonium sulfate, ceric ammonium nitrate. Dichrometry, they use potassium dichromate as a titrant. Iodometry, we use the liberated iodine. Permanganometry, it uses potassium permanganate. We have already seen a practical of permanganometry. No indicator is needed as KMnO4 acts as self-indicator. What is hygroscopicity? So we had discussed in primary standards that they should not be hygroscopic. So hygroscopicity is the tendency of substance to absorb moisture when exposed to moist air. What is deliquescent substance? When the substance absorbs moisture from the air and converts to liquid, it is said to be deliquescent. What are the methods to perform assay? So one of the methods we have already seen, volumetric analysis, that is various types of titrations. It is one of the classical method, or you can say chemical method. Next method is photometry. Herein we use the property of the substance, how it interacts with the visible region of light. In spectrophotometry, we determine how the substance interacts with the ultraviolet region, and based on this we can quantify the substance. Then chromatography, it is a basically separation technique. But once the substances get separated, we can isolate them and quantify them. Next is flame photometry. It is one of the emission spectroscopy. Thank you.